Hi, Film Yappers. My name is Mo Hammond, and this is
Adia Chaney.
All right, the way this works is we each have a movie scorecard, and we give it a rating out of 5 points on the plot, acting, music, visual effects, script writing, rewatchability, and our total score out of 30. And then finally, we kind of sum it up by giving it our star rating out of 5 different stars. And for the first episode, I chose to do Pulp Fiction, which is my all-time personal favorite movie. And I've never actually sat down to give it a rating based on these different categories. So for those that are not interested in watching the whole review, just stick around for a second and I'll give mine and Adia's final scorecards.
So what's our first category?
First category is a plot slash story. Okay. So what was your rating of it, the plot slash story?
I did a 4 out of 5.
Okay, why'd you give it a 4 out of 5?
Because I overall absolutely love it.
Yeah.
The only thing that kind of kept it from a 5 for me is that it is a bit scattered, mm-hmm. and it feels a lot more like different vignettes that are put together to tell an overall story rather than like one big cohesive story.
Yeah.
Which I think could have worked a little better mm-hmm. for this because it is meant to be that way, but it's not exactly presented that way.
Say a little bit more about that. What you mean, like, say a little bit more, it's like not meant to be?
Yeah, so it's, I feel like he's trying to tell an overall story.
Mm-hmm.
But what happens is, especially because he like breaks it up into parts where he titles them, it feels a lot more like different short stories mm-hmm. that are coming together to tell a big story.
Right.
And I think it could have worked just a little bit better if it was less broken up that way and
gotcha.
Just overall one big cohesive story.
Like if it flowed without like the movie breaks and like this is the scene, this is Marcellus and the ball, I mean this is John Travolta and Mia Wallace and that kind of thing,
yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Okay. Because there's like him and Jules and mm-hmm. then there's John and Mia, and I think that it would have been better if it like went from one into the other a little
gotcha.
Bit more
gotcha.
Directly.
Kind of float. And I think it's some of his research.
Once Upon a Time in Hollywood is a little bit like that. It's a lot more cohesive, but you do see like Leo's character
mm-hmm.
in like one transition to another. So like in different stages of his life and career. But that one flows just a little bit more smoothly,
yep.
I think,
yep.
than Pulp Fiction does.
I got you. If they would have taken that kind of same flow like you're saying, like hadn't broken it up, it would have maybe just flowed as like one story.
Yeah, because sometimes I feel like I'm trying to piece together different parts of this movie. Mm-hmm. Like, okay, so how is this related to what Vince did earlier?
Right.
And that kind of thing.
Right. For the plot slash story, I gave it a 5 out of 5. And to your point, I think maybe upon first view, I wouldn't have given it a 5 out of 5. But since I've seen it so many times, all of these like nuances and these things kind of come together and they blend. And so I feel like it tells that one cohesive story of what Jules and Vincent's journey through being hitmen.
Yeah.
Right. And I feel like at the end, it kind of proves that point. But upon first view, I probably would have missed a lot of the nuances and the decisions that all come together in the end. I gave it a 5 out of 5, but I do agree with a lot of your points that, like, upon first view, I would have missed a lot of those things. There we go. We are switching camera angles, so excuse the jumpiness of the shot, but we are switching to a new one. Our next category is acting.
So what did you give acting?
Acting, I gave a 3 out of 5, and I gave it a 3 out of 5. Don't agree with me on that one. I gave it a 3 out of 5 strictly because Tarantino does such an awful job. Like this is an ensemble cast of like good actors. Everybody's pretty rock solid in it. Everybody from like the major to the minor characters. But Tarantino's that scene is just so off-putting to me. His blatant use of the N-word, and I think
that is a bit much.
I think he was going to use the N-word regardless. So,
I understand given the rest of the movie why that happens. I think without the context of the rest of the movie, that is jarring at a bare minimum.
Yeah.
But I agree that it's a bit much, especially since he is friends with Jules. But I like Tarantino in that scene purely because the rest of the cast is massive actors. And I feel like that makes sense for what's happening in that scene.
Yeah.
Because it's very clear that his character is not in this life. That is not what he does.
Yeah.
He's not... used to people showing up with dead bodies in their car.
Right, right.
And so he's meant to seem out of place in that way.
Gotcha.
And so I think that's why Tarantino puts himself in there, is because he is so awkward and he knows that it's supposed to be an awkward scene.
Got you. I think, okay, so look, Tarantino was going to be either the drug dealer or he was going to be the old friend of Jules, right? So he was going to be either one of those, but in both of those roles, either of those white men, they're using the N-word. Like the drug dealer uses it when he's talking to Vincent about whether or not he's going to rip him off.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
he uses the N-word. It was the hard, and it's not just the N-word, it's the N-word with the hard R.
It is, yes.
That's what I don't like.
I also agree, I don't love that. When watching it. I understand that Tarantino is like that, and I think one of the only reasons that we all are okay with it is because he's friends with Samuel Jackson in a very clear way.
Yeah, but then he would use it with an A and not the hard R. If they were homeboys, it would have been.
I didn't even notice that.
Yeah, it's the hard R version of it.
Yeah.
As a matter of fact, I think that's why Spike Lee has a problem with him, is because the hard R use is so blatant. And for some characters, like if it would have been those rednecks using the hard R, I
would have
been fine with it. It would have made sense, right? But if this your homeboy, you're not going to drop the hard R and say this is not storage for hard R's.
Yeah.
So because of that, and because I think it's a little sloppy, like, I don't know if it's the writing or if it's the acting, but I just wanted to say the word. I took him 2 points down, so I gave it 3 out of 5.
That is understandable. That is very fair. I think the only reason it doesn't affect my score is because there are arguments to be made that, like, words are just words.
Right, right.
And I think that Tarantino, I don't agree with that all the time, but I think Tarantino is doing it in a stylistic way to make his characters seem more realistic.
Okay.
Because there would be a lot of slang thrown around regardless, and there is, not nearly as much, but there definitely is, and I think he's trying to do that to show that, like, his characters are normal, gritty
people. Right, right. Okay.
But I'm still with you. I think it is excessive at the very least. But Tarantino being in the scene, I think, works despite that, just because he's so clearly out of place.
Yeah,
awkward looking and not a professional actor.
Correct.
So it emphasizes the point that, like, that guy, this has nothing to do with him.
Right, right. Okay, I feel you.
So that's it. But, like, every other performance is amazing.
Okay. Yeah.
I love Uma Thurman. I think she does such a good job at playing Mia. She does, like, the subtleties of Mia very well, because we hear a lot about Mia before we see her.
Right.
So it's hard for us to make a decision on, like, was Antoine being thrown out of a window her fault or not?
Right.
And then we meet her and we're like, it very well could have been.
Yeah.
Not saying it was, but based off of her and Vince's adventures, not gonna say it's out of the question.
Yeah. It's one of those lingering questions too, because then, you know, if had she not overdosed, how would that have played out? Do you know what I'm saying? They were getting quite comfortable before she overdosed.
And not that is convenient.
Yeah.
But I think it might have kept Vince from being thrown out of a window.
Yeah, maybe. I think so.
And I mean, he was trying his best, definitely. I love their dancing. It is so iconic and ridiculous.
Yeah, and often emulated and never duplicated. And
I also love that, like, Tarantino used, like, inspiration from old, like, dancing, like, movies and TV shows to kind of build the style that he wanted them to do, and they absolutely understood the assignment. It is so ridiculous and goofy looking.
Yeah.
So, I love that.
Anything else to the point of acting?
I mean, what are your thoughts on Sam's performance? Because that's something that gets brought up a lot.
Sam, like, he's your homeboy. Okay, yeah, Samuel L. Jackson. I think the first time I watched the movie, I fell in love with that movie because of his character.
Accurate.
Because talk shit like I talk shit, and he's insightful in the way that makes the end of the movie make so much sense. You know what I'm saying? When he's talking shit, and Vincent doesn't like that. You know, when they get to the coffee shop, because he's like, "Hey, you're not being the same you."
Right.
Like the you from the first act, which, like I said, I fell in love with. That's not him in the final act, because now he's self-reflective. He's trying to figure out, like, am I making the right decision? Is my life headed in the right direction? And that's what I love about that character. He's very dynamic in that way.
Yeah, and I even love at the end, like when him and Vince are sitting in like the diner,
mm-hmm.
and Vince is asking some very valid questions, like, so what are you going to do?
Yeah,
because it's not like that lifestyle offers career alternatives.
Right.
And so I do love that even his character, like Jules, doesn't have an answer
mm-hmm.
for that.
Mm-hmm.
All he knows is that he wants out of this life, and I think that works really well as his, like, defining characteristic.
Yeah. Yeah.
I gave this a 3.5 out of 5. I am in no way saying that the soundtrack isn't amazing, because it absolutely is, and I think that, like, all of the different songs fit the scenes perfectly. I just think that the soundtrack is a bit overused, and that there are some moments where, like, the song choices could have been of the same tone but a little bit more subtle, because there are definitely times for me where the soundtrack overplays what's happening.
Okay, can you give me an example of that?
Yeah.
I don't want to break your thought, but I want to kind of get an example
of
that. I probably might overlay something that you're thinking.
So it's the scene where Mia and Vince get back from their night out.
Yeah.
It's while Vince is in the bathroom. Mia turns on the record player.
Yeah, yeah.
And I don't know the name
She's
going to
be a woman tonight,
yes.
Right? And then yeah, the guitar's wrong.
I think, like, I 100% get why that is like that.
Mm-hmm.
I think it would have worked well to have almost just the music a little bit quieter,
mm-hmm.
or a slightly less on the nose mm-hmm. song playing in the background, so that we can focus way more on what Mia is feeling.
Gotcha.
Going through.
Gotcha.
Because we are supposed to be kind of breaking down, like, whether or not her character is somebody who could be responsible
right.
for getting someone else tossed out of a window.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
so to get to see more of her, like, natural through that without having such a loud, overt soundtrack over it, I think would also have made the moment where she overdoses way more impactful, because it would have come, like, in the middle of all of these varying things.
Gotcha.
And, like, you wouldn't be distracted by this huge song that's almost trying to spell out for you
right.
what's going on.
Right. No, I feel you on that. Overall, I gave it a 5 out of 5. I don't have any qualms about it. I like, for the most part, his song selections, Reservoir Dogs, this one. Kill Bill was scored by the RZA. I mean, like, all of his music selection. And Jackie Brown had, like, great, like, 70s type music and stuff that I hadn't really heard. Like, he kind of opened my eyes to some music that I wasn't hip to. And
I
think that's why I gave it, like, a 5 out of 5, because I was like, yo, this kind of rocks. Like, this jams. I wouldn't have picked this. And I know about this song, and just it all comes together and works pretty well, I think. But I get what you're saying, to your point about that particular scene and that being on the nose and stuff like that.
Yeah, but, like, I agree with you. The songs, all of the entire soundtrack works perfectly.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it sets the tone and the theme for the entire movie, and it makes a ton of sense. I don't even think it would be the same without it. So, I definitely agree with you.
Cool.
Our next category is visual effects and cinematography. And I'm going to go ahead and let you start. What did you give that category?
Again, no surprise, I gave that a perfect score. I just think that the way that there were some scenes in there that I feel like are pretty unmatched. There is the intensity of the overdose scene with the adrenaline shot.
That's the one I picked as, like, my favorite.
Yes, and just the way it builds up. And I think that brings up my point again. I think why Esther Tarantino chose to be the old friend of Jules as opposed to being the drug dealer, because he wanted to be behind the camera for that drug, that overdose scene.
Yeah, which I
because
think
it was
good,
so intense.
Such a good place for
yeah.
him too. I'm glad that he made that choice.
It's frantic. There's a lot going on, and I just feel like the way that that's put together is awesome. I love his framing of the shots. There is like the shot with when you're first introduced to Marcellus Wallace, where Bruce Willis's character sitting across from him, and there's that like over the head shot. Yeah, there's that weird Band-Aid on the back of his neck.
And you never even see Marcellus until way later.
Right. You see his, you hear his voice, and you know he's supposed to be this big, powerful like character. Like, and I just love the way that it's put together in that way. Just visually, it's very pleasing to me. And that kind of, I saw that movie before I saw Reservoir Dogs, and ever since then, I've just appreciated just his overall way that he just frame shots. And it's because he's a student of the game.
Mm-hmm.
Like, there is the scene where Marcellus is crossing. Okay, so Bruce Willis has to go back to his apartment.
Yes, right? I love
Bruce Willis, and he went to go get the coffee and the donuts or whatever, and he's walking back to the car, and he stops and turns, and he's like, hold up. But that scene is, like, exactly the same scene from the movie Psycho, where the, I can't remember the main character in that, but she's leaving town. She's ditching work, and when she's at the light, her boss crosses in front of her, and he kind of stops and looks, and like, I don't know where I pick up this information from, or where I've learned this, but I'm like, yo, that's taken from somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
And they've teased Tarantino often because he pays homage to, or you know, he's given his, tipping his hat to other directors and people that have influenced him. But just being a lay person that's not like a movie connoisseur, like in that sense, like I'm not an encyclopedia of knowledge like he is.
Yeah.
If you've ever listened to him talk movies, or
I know, it's so,
it's like, dude, like he can like recite like almost like biblical scripture, certain scenes from movies and certain things that he's trying to emulate, and it just all blends together in this movie really well.
Yeah, and I definitely get what you mean. Like, people give him a lot of flack for, you know, they think it's like ripping off.
Right, right.
I disagree. I feel like he is very open about the fact that he's inspired by other directors, movie creators. And so I think it works, like, well.
Yeah.
Because even though it is still, you know, inspired by something else, he makes it his own.
Mm-hmm.
And back to your point about the drug dealer scene.
Yeah.
Everything about that scene is perfect. The way Vince pulls his car up on this guy's
right.
And I love the actor who's playing the drug dealer, because he's responding the way a legitimate drug dealer would probably respond.
Right.
He's like, don't come here.
Yeah.
But Vince is just like, this is your problem now.
Right.
And like, there's a camera angle in that scene where he's looking for a textbook.
Yeah.
And like, his wife Jody is in the back, and you can just kind of see part of both of them in the shot.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
The guy's going in and out, and Jody's like coming from the side, and it's almost jarring to look at as an audience member, but it definitely communicates how frantic that scene is.
Yeah.
So I agree with you there. All of the shots are beautiful, and like, they all play a role in the story, which I think is great.
Yeah. Overall, visually, what did you score it?
I gave it a 5 out of 5.
5 out of 5, perfect score as well.
It's absolutely great.
Okay. Good. Okay, our next category is script and writing, /writing, just how the movie was written, how it comes across on the screen. What did you give it?
I gave it a 4 out of 5.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the only thing that kept it from being a 5 out of 5 for me is kind of the same thing with category 1, which is the plot and the story, is just that it is a little bit broken up, but dialogue is perfect.
Yeah.
I love the way that Tarantino writes dialogue. It's very natural, but also idealistic. Like, it's almost the way that people wish that they could talk, because his characters get across so much more meaning than what they actually say. But it still sounds normal. Like, you would still think, like, oh, these are just two normal people talking. Especially conversations between Vince and Jules. They are so natural, but they divulge so much plot, and you learn so much about each of those characters based off of just the small differences between their language choices.
Yeah. And I think what I like about it is that it seems like mundane, day-to-day conversation, but then later there'll be a callback. So, like, you know, we have the conversation about the hamburgers and what's the difference between the hamburgers over there and over here. And then later on, when they're actually in the apartment, then it gets called back. Like, hey, you know the difference between, you know, a quarter, why don't I call it a quarter pounder?
Done.
Exactly.
Yeah, he doesn't waste any words.
Mm-hmm.
Like, every single thing, even frivolous conversations pay off, like you said.
Yeah.
And so that, to me, just makes it, like, perfect dialogue.
Yeah.
Which, like, carries the movie so far.
Mm-hmm. yeah, I agree. The dialogue between the characters is something that I like look forward to in Tarantino movies. There's just so much there with so little.
You can quote so many
lines. Yeah, they're quotables. They're quotables. I'm going to overlay my favorite quotable in here. But what doesn't work for me, and the reason why I docked at a point, is just because it would otherwise be close to a perfect movie. But there is just that scene with the gimp and Marcella's being violated. That it doesn't do it for me. It never has. Upon multiple rewatches, I've never been comfortable with it. I mean, I know it's supposed to make you feel uncomfortable, but I'm thinking
too uncomfortable.
Tarantino, bro, you creative genius. You could have something else could have been fit or swapped into that scene. It worked just as well.
That is also what kept it from a 5 out of 5. I don't even watch that scene when I rewatch the movie, because it works just as well without it.
Right.
Almost nothing changes. Like, right. I straight up skip it because it is entirely too much for me. And it doesn't really change the plot at all.
It doesn't change the plot, but I think that something big had to happen for Marcellus to leave Bruce Willis's character to go.
Yeah.
Something big had to happen.
I understand why he needed a reason.
Yeah.
I think there were a lot of other reasons.
Yeah, could have been plenty of other reasons.
I could think of 12.
Okay. I give you that. I agree with you on that one for sure. Okay. Anything else to the script or the writing?
No, I mean, it's just kind of like what we said. Everything pays off. Every single line is worth it. And to that, like, for me, that just absolutely does.
Yeah.
So, what do you think? How often would you rewatch this movie?
I've seen this movie countless times. I first saw it when I was a spry chicken at like 17, 18, and now I'm 40. And so I don't know how many times I've seen it over the year. I mean, there have been some years where I haven't seen the movie, but every time I watch it, it's just something new to appreciate, something new to like. But just kind of like you were talking about in the last category, I don't recommend this movie for other people because of that particular scene. Like, you know, people don't like to see overdose, people don't like to see violence, and I do. But not like, I don't want to see some of those scenes. Like, I don't want to watch them over and over again. I get the point. I get what you're trying to do, I guess. But it just detracts a little bit for me. I think I might even change my score. What did I say? I gave it.
You said a 4.
5 out of 5. I gave it a 5 out of 5. I'd probably give it a 4 out of 5 because of that.
That does it for me too.
The recommendation I would give to other people, I would not recommend this movie for rewatchability. And I can't watch it with my wife. I've been together with my wife for like 10 years and we've never watched the movie together. I've not recommended for her because I know she's not gonna like this. She's gonna look at me like, why did you tell me to watch this movie?
Yeah, if I had known anything about it going in, it might have been a hard sell for me, but I watched it kind of just knowing the quotable lines from it and that Uma Thurman does a funny dance.
Yeah.
And so I was not prepared for some of the things that went into it. So I've only seen the movie like 2 or 3 times.
Yeah.
And that is enough for me for a while.
Yeah.
I'll probably watch it again, and I would even recommend it to people who have a thick skin.
Yeah.
And I would warn them.
Yeah.
I was like, there are some things that are uncomfortable, but it is worth it, I think. I would say.
Yeah. I think it's worth it, at least for the quotables and just for the way that the story comes together at the end and the non-linear timeline. I like that kind of thing, and I would recommend it to people. There are other movies that have copied those bits from Tarantino, just like he's paid homage. Other people have paid homage to him time and time again over the years, in the same fashion. So, 4 out of 5. So I'm changing my score on the spot. Yeah.
That's a fair change, I think.
Okay, and then we could just kind of let this run and just do our like overall like rating, like out of a 5-star scale. How many stars would you give this movie?
Honestly, same as I would give it, like the script and writing, 4 out of 5. For a lot of the reasons we discussed, is that one scene is enough to take it from a 5 out of 5 for me. But other than that, like, it is almost a perfect movie. I think a 4 out of 5. What about you?
Okay. Yeah, I gave it a 4.5 out of 5. I probably would have been on the same like train as you, but there's just like that I keep coming back to the movie and I keep learning things as I go back to the movie.
Yeah,
and that's why I gave it a 4.5 as opposed to 4. Because it is damn near a perfect movie. But there are some elements that would be different, and the fact that I can't just recommend it to people means it's not a 5 out of 5 movie. Like.
Yeah, I can't recommend it to everyone.
Yeah,
there would
be
very specific people I might recommend it to. So yeah, I agree. It is excellent. It is an excellent film.
So my question to everybody and to the audience is there a movie that you love that you would recommend to other people? Do you have a movie like that? Or is this one of those kind of movies that's just like, love it, but you wouldn't recommend it?
This is definitely one of them. I love making people watch movies that I love. So there are very few movies that I wouldn't recommend, but this one would definitely be bottom of the list. Probably Inglourious Basterds 2.
Okay.
Just because Tarantino is so intense with his filmmaking that it is not for everybody. It's not a thing. I mean, you can go into it lightheartedly. You will be surprised.
Yeah.
But same thing, just the amount of violence and some of the language choices are less than ideal, so I could see how some people would appreciate that.
Right, right. For me, other than Pulp Fiction, the movie would be Requiem for a Dream. The Aronofsky movie. Have you seen that before?
No.
Okay. I wouldn't recommend it. So, similarly, I love that movie. It's shot really well, but it's just super depressing. And at the end, like, it doesn't have one of those little wrap with a bow, happy endings. But it was very cool to watch, and I've seen that movie multiple times, too.
Depressing,
but it just makes you feel like...
from start to finish.
No, not depressing from start to finish, because, like I said, it's about drug use, and, you know, while they're on their highs, it's high, and it's pretty cool for them, you know, but then you see the decline and kind of, like, what it morphs into.
And it becomes less...
Yeah, I wouldn't say I would probably describe it as endearing, but like, I don't know if it was ever endearing, but it's an entertaining movie. But then when it starts to like delve into like the lows and kind of like what you might see with like drug addiction, then you're like, I don't want to see the pitfalls and like nothing good happening for these people. So for me, that's another one of those movies. But if you have a movie that you feel similarly, like you love, but you would not recommend to other people, just drop it in the chat, in the comments.
Yeah.
This has been our first episode, so thanks for watching. We might have Adia back next time or another time to talk about another film. And if you would like to come talk trash on the movie, talk trash about a movie, or talk highly about a movie, I invite you to do so. Thanks for joining us today.